the previous lecture, I described how one can obtain the Galilean group algebra from the Poincare group 1 by taking the limit that the magnitude of velocity is much smaller than the speed of light, and that gives rise to certain scaling of the various generators, and one can keep the leading order terms in all the commutation rules to get the simplified algebra. This is the technique known as Inono-Wigner contraction, and I will write down the Galilean algebra rather soon. And before that, I want to correct signs in the equations which I wrote down in the previous lecture. The commutators with k actually have opposite signs compared to what I wrote, and actually it is a good exercise in all this algebra to check these factors of plus or minus 1 or indices going up and down, etcetera, to make sure that the relations remain correct. The only non-trivial relations which arise from this algebra are from the generators which scale differently compared to the generators which do not scale at all, and in this particular case they happen to be the boost generators as well as the zeroth component of the 4 momentum. And so, one can take the Lorentz algebra, and the only one which are different are the ones involving this k and p 0, and I will only write down those ones which now behave differently in the case of Galilean group. One particular relation which arises is the boost generators. They commute with each other because they scale as 1 over v, and the right hand side does not scale. So, one can take the leading term and reduce all the sub leading terms to 0. So, this is what comes out. The other non-trivial commutations rules are those involving momenta. So, p I and k j again keeping only the leading term, it produces minus I m delta I j. The third one is the relation involving p 0 and k I. Now, this survives, but in a different form, that the leading term of p 0 does not give any contribution to the commutator. It is a number, the rest mass. So, that relation reduces to w k I is equal to minus I p I, and all the rest essentially remains the same. One just has to replace the non-relativistic expressions instead of the relativistic ones, and in particular the commutator with the rest mass term is always 0. So, these are the non-trivial relations for the Galilean group. These are the ones which are different. The ones which are same, I have not bothered to write down, and in particular one can replace the p 0 by the operator w in all the other cases, j and p remains the same. So, this is essentially the simplified Galilean algebra, and one sees a peculiar feature in this particular case that the boost operators produce a commutator which is essentially a constant, the mass of the particle. If that were not the case, we could have simultaneously taken eigenstates of both the momentum operators as well as the boost operators, but they leave behind this mass term, this m it's an example of what is called central charge. In the algebra, there are different ways of dealing with it. Since it's only a number, when the algebra gets exponentiated to the group transformation, it will produce phases. And whenever such phases come in, we have to worry about the possibility of changing the rules for superposition, because objects with transform with different phases, they cannot be superposed. So, there is a super selection rule. And that is states with different values of m cannot be superposed. Sometimes this thing is also referred to as a projective representation. This gives relations between transformations which are true until a phase is ignored. If the phase is there, then one has to take care of it a little differently. So, a generic structure will look like, if I take a transformation T 1 first and then the transformation T 2, it is a equivalent to the transformation T 2 T 1, which will be required by the group composition law, but only up to a overall phase which is a function of T 2 and T 1. These phases can be conveniently handled in quantum theory, because they do not have any absolute meaning, and one can then still constructs this so called projective representations which are useful in defining quantum states. The only thing one has to watch out for is, one cannot take two different objects having two different values of phi and superpose them, and that is exactly the superposition rule, and that will appear when you try to combine the operations of boost with a translation in the case of Galilean group. So, this is one way of stating the constraint of super selection rule and the value of mass in Galilean group. The alternative is one can interpret m as a extra generator, and since it is just going to produce a phase, it will be an abelian generator, and then it will it will have some eigenvalue for each physical state, and again it leads to the same conclusion that, well, you cannot superpose two different states with different eigenvalues. So, again you cannot combine states with different values of mass. So, this choice of whether to count this central charge as a projective representation or interpret it as an extra generator in the algebra, it is a matter of language. The conclusion is that one has to treat objects with different values of mass in Galilean algebra as different physical states, and they cannot be superposed with each other. So, this is the essence of reducing Lorentz group to Galilean group and see what kind of things emerges. And I will leave it at that. There are other techniques of how to deal with projective representation and central charge, but it is a matter of group theory. So, now let me go to a new topic, which is to completely classify the states. I will stick to the simplest situation, which is talking about single particle. When one talks about many particles, there will be other questions involving statistics and exchange that I will not go into any detail, but to do this we need to specify a set of mutually commuting generators of the symmetric group. We have already seen that this set of P mu commute and are conventionally taken to be part of this set. So, every state will be labeled by its four momentum vector, and the obvious Casimir operator, which can be created from this, the quadratic contraction p mu, which happens to be equal to m square, is a invariant for this classification. We automatically have one important number coming from this, which is the mass of the particle. Now, we want to find out, are there any other objects which we can combine with p mu to specify the states more explicitly, and for that we have to find some other components out of the Lorentz group generators which commute with P mu, and this requires some amount of algebra because there are 6 of the homogeneous Lorentz group generators, and which one commute with P mu or not will have to be deduced by doing various commutations, and we already have seen that the commutators of P with J in general will produce some combination of momentum on the right hand side. And so, we have to take some combination of J's so that the right hand commutator vanishes. This was worked out in full detail by Wigner. He provided a complete classification of states and their quantum numbers for the Poincaré group. I am only going to give you the answer instead of going through the whole algebra, but it is easy to see how the answer works. The answer is given in terms of a object which is constructed from this generator, which is called Pauli-Lubansky vector, and it is defined by the relation the completely anti-symmetric symbol contracted with one factor of momentum and one factor of angular momentum. So, this is a object which transforms as a vector because everything is indexed according to the Lorentz symmetry, and it has 4 different components. Now, it is very easy to see that these objects commute with the momentum vector for a very simple reason, that if I take a commutator of P alpha with W mu, the non-trivial commutator arises between P alpha and J lambda sigma, but that commutator is proportional to momentum with one of the index of lambda or sigma sitting on that momentum term, and then the complete anti-symmetry of the symbol with 2 factors of momenta contracted with it produces 0. So, we automatically have this simple consequence that these objects commute with momenta. It is also true that because of the anti-symmetry, if you contract this thing with momenta because of the same anti-symmetric symbol, that produces 0 as well. So, literally speaking, these are vectors which in some sense are orthogonal to the momentum vectors. They are legitimate candidates for choosing as new operators to label the states, because for fixed P mu, because we have already chosen momentum to be the eigen operators for the states. So, P will have some value, and in that particular case, these are linear combinations of the generators of the homogeneous Lorentz group. So, they can be treated as valid candidates on which we will impose the eigenvalue condition. Particular, we can now choose some components of the W to be simultaneous eigenvectors with the 4 momenta which we classified, and we can construct a new property in addition to the 4 momentum and the mass which we used, and that now becomes a additional label, and that label actually quantifies the value of the spin. This W mu, as it turns out, do not commute with each other, so in that sense they are similar to the angular momentum operators, where various components do not commute. The momentum components commute with each other, but this one is more like the angular momentum, and as I said, it will be identified with spin rather soon, and one can actually prove, which I am not going to go into detail about what this consequences of this commutation rules are, but is follows from the same algebra that the commutators of W produces again a W and P. If you again take P to be some eigenvalue, so this is a group property for fixed P sigma. The algebra closes, P sigma reduces to a number, and then commutators of W is another W. So, the W actually do form a group for the states with fixed eigenvalues of the four momentum, and much of the classification of the single particle states now becomes a question of identifying this group and labeling its representations and eigenvalues, etcetera. So, this is a very useful quantity to handle, and the answer which arises from this thing is the Casimir operator, which is a square of this W. It actually quantifies spin of the whatever particle or state which we are talking about. And this is a important label for finding out what are the eigen operators or quantum numbers for Lorentz group. It turns out that after this P mu and W mu, there is nothing more, in the sense that there is no further operator which commutes with all of these and give a new label, and we have exhausted the list of all possible quantum numbers that we can construct. One can now look at various possibilities of single particle states one by one. The group produced by the set of W mu, it depends on the value of M square, and that is the complete classification which Wigner had to work out in order to find the appropriate label for all possible quantum states following the symmetry of the Lorentz group. Let me also state at this stage that the unitary representations which are needed for specifying any quantum state they are not finite dimensional as far as the Poincaré group is concerned, and so the labels will correspond to infinite number of possibilities. One way to look at it in the scheme which we are following, that the momenta which we have chosen to label the states are unbounded, and that is the part of infinite dimensionality which shows up in labeling the quantum states. On the other hand, the labels produced by this W mu set of generators, they turn out to have finite dimensional representations, and they are useful, and those are the finite dimensional representations corresponding to the spin of the particle. And to do that, we now define a concept which Wigner invented. There is an object called a little group, and this little group are transformations that leave the momentum value invariant. And momentum value we have already taken to be the eigenstate. So, these are operators which can be reduced to a number. So, there are four numbers, and we can pick a fixed frame to describe them. And the remaining part of the Lorentz generators, which will leave those four vectors specifying p mu unchanged, they correspond to the little group. It is obviously a group, because if one of them leaves invariant, then the second one, which can be composed with it, will also leave it invariant. There is no problem with that, and it is a subset of the Lorentz group. And I will denote them by the symbol Lorentz group. I use the symbol lambda, and I will now use a symbol W for this little group transformation, and they have the particular property that acting on this momentum eigenvalues, the values are left as they are. So, this so called little group, they identify the so called spin of the representation, a new quantum label which is different from the four momentum. So, the first job is to now take some eigenstate of this four momenta and construct this little group, and then look at this little group and its representation and try to quantify them in full detail, and that will give a label which we will immediately see corresponds to spin of the particular particle. Now, I will just make a little table which will give all possibilities of these four vectors, which are distinct from each other in a topological sense, that one cannot convert one of them to the other one by any continuous Lorentz transformation. So, let me construct that various p mu. Of course, the trivial possibility is that this whole thing is 0, and this is actually not a single particle state, but rather what we will call the vacuum, the ground state of the whole system, and by definition it will have 0 energy momentum value, and everything which leaves it invariant is now the complete Lorentz group. SO3,1, because 0 is left invariant by any of the homogeneous Lorentz group transformation. So, this is a case which is actually not a one particle state, but it is a quantum state nonetheless, it is a 0 particle state. What we are more interested in are the single particle states, and for that we have to now separate different sectors of the invariant p square. So, there is this so called time like vector p square equal to m square positive, which corresponds to a vector of the form m 0 0 0. Of course, this particular form corresponds to a massive particle and in the rest frame, and this particular form of the p mu is convenient because one can work out all the algebra in this particular frame, and since the Lorentz index is explicit, can easily see what all will happen in a arbitrary inertial frame. So, this particular case describes a 4 vector with only a non-zero time component, and of course, the little group for that now will correspond to leaving this component invariant, and it is a group which will mix these 3 space components with each other without any restriction, and we know what that particular group is from our general experience. This is nothing but the group of rotations which mix the space components while leaving the time component as it is. So, for these massive particles, the little group is nothing but the rotation group, and we know its complete algebra, what it is, as well as its representation. These are all the famous angular momentum representations which we have dealt with, and since now we can use them as labels, we have the angular momentum of the particle in the rest frame, which is nothing but the spin. There is no orbital angular momentum in the rest frame, and so it will produce now a label which we will use for a generic particle, may be moving, may be not moving, but the particle must have a mass. So, there will be some particular frame in which it is at rest. So, this is one possibility. Now, the next possibility is little non-trivial, and that corresponds to this value of p square being equal to 0. In this particular case, there is no rest frame possible, and the best one can do in simplifying the 4 vector is write this thing as 1 time and 1 space component of equal magnitude. So, the p square essentially becomes 0. So, this is a massless particle moving along z axis, and the little group for this now will be all transformations which leave this particular form invariant. Clearly, that will involve rotation of one and two components with each other, but the group is actually larger than that. One can also mix the time and the z component in a particular way to arrive at that particular combination, which will still leave it invariant. And just as in the case of massive particle, out of the four dimensions, we have selected one dimension to label the p mu, and the other three dimensions can be mixed appropriately to create a group. Here also there will be other three dimensions which can be mixed. Those dimensions are a little non-trivial because of the specific four vectors, but the group can be obtained from them, and it is a mixing of three different directions, and that can be done just as in the rotation group with three different generators. So, it is a group which will have three generators, but the group is different. It is called the Euclidean group in two dimension, which are basically the transformations of a flat plane, which leave the geometry invariant, and those are one rotation about a axis orthogonal to the plane, as well as two translations which correspond to movement in the plane, and these three form a group, and that actually is the group arising in the case of this p square equal to 0 or massless particles. We will soon describe that in more detail, but it is a non-trivial result, not as easy to see as in the case of massive particles. And the third possibility left by the mathematics, but ruled out by any physical state, is this vector p mu is space like, and it will correspond to a frame conveniently chosen that one of the space component is non-zero and all the other three components are 0. This will correspond to a particle which has been labeled as a tachyon, a fictional particle, because we have never seen any one of these things in the real world. Mathematically, it is allowed, and just as in analogy of the rotation group, now we have three components which we can mix with each other, and it produces a little group which is SO 2 comma 1, because the one of the component is time like and the other two components are space like. This one is unphysical. So, essentially we are reduced to studying this two cases, p square not 0 equal to a positive value and p square equal to 0. The little groups SO 3 and E 2 have finite dimensional unitary representations, and we will use those quadratic Casimir operators like square of W to label this representation. In the case of rotation group, that is a familiar strategy, and we will do that in a little while. Before that, I want to explain the structure of this Euclidean group in two dimension in a little more detail, because it's a group which is little bit unusual. E2 can be visualized as the limit of rotation group with the radius of sphere on which the rotations act going to the limit infinity, and then looking not at an arbitrary point on the sphere, but examining the neighborhood of, say, the north pole, which defines the axis of rotation. This limiting procedure is again an example of what I mentioned in the last lecture, so called Inono-Wigner contraction. So, let me now do that rather explicitly. And we have to now work out the scaling of the generators. In this particular case, the generators belong to the rotation group. Now, we can write down the what happens to J1, J2 and J3 in this particular case. So, this is say the z axis, and there is a sphere its radius r, and we are studying what is happening in this particular neighborhood of the north pole. Now, clearly if you define J component wise, it has a structure r cross p. If I look at the J3, by choosing this particular scale, nothing much happens to it. It is a rotation around the third axis, and the blowing up of the radius does not do anything, and we can keep J3 of order 1. But on the other hand, J1 and J2, which have a transverse relation, and so if you define them, it will have r cross p with one of the radius components equal to this capital R, that is the third component of the radius vector r, which will appear in the definition of J1 and J2. And so, these things end up scaling as r. The third component of radius does not appear in the definition of J3. So, now we take the angular momentum algebra and ask what happens to this particular situation. So, this is a consequence, if you want to say so, that x3 scales as r, but x1 and x2 remain of order 1 when one is in the neighborhood of the north pole. One can now redefine the scaling by explicitly factoring out the radius r, and then the relation automatically emerges. The commutator of J1 and J2 gives J3, but because of the extra factors of r, we have now the simplified relation that this 2 new generators, the scale generators, commute. On the other hand, the commutator of J3 with J1 will produce J2, and that the factor of R just scales out. And the other two relations look like whatever is there in the rotation group. And this is now the algebra of the Euclidean group in two dimensions. We treated A and B as rotations here as well, but one can now see what happens when the radius becomes very large. The neighborhood of the north pole is almost like a flat plane, and this rotations about J1 and J2, the axis which are orthogonal to the third axis, are essentially now little translations away from the north pole, and this A and B, they correspond to the two translations. So, we essentially get out translation generator from the rotation part by factoring out that r. Means it is essentially by definition, because j was r cross p, r we already factored out, what is left is a translation, and the directions got cleverly picked out. So, the algebra emerges. So, this is the method of obtaining the Euclidean group in two dimensional by a contraction of the rotation group. What happens in the case of massless particles is, this is the algebra which arises not in terms of directly the components of W which we have seen, but in terms of what are known as light cone coordinates. These are the coordinates which are defined by the notation x plus or minus is equal to x 0 plus or minus x 3. So, it is a component of the zeroth or the time part and the space part along which the particle is moving. And so, these are the directions in which light rays will propagate. The two extreme limits of the so called Minkowski space time in which physical signal can be transmitted, and for that reason they are referred to as a light cone coordinates. Clearly, instead of using x 0 and x 3, one can use x plus and x minus as also a valid complete description of the coordinates. And the relations between the components of W simplifies in light cone coordinates in the case of massless particles. And that now can be seen. I will give you the answer for massless particles, which means the p mu which we are going to use have the structure of the four components k, 0, 0, k, and one can easily deduce that the w minus component identically vanishes in that particular case. That is the one which separates out the direction with a specific relation to the momenta. And then we are left with the algebra satisfied by the remaining three components, which are W 1, W 2 and W plus, that algebra is that of E 2. So, in this manner one can explicitly verify that yes, the little group in the case of massless particles is indeed E 2, the original x, y, z identical components are not very clear about demonstrating them, but one can transform to this light cone coordinates where the algebra is clearly seen, and then one can now ask about labeling the states by this irreducible representations of this Euclidean group in two dimensions. This essentially is a complete description of various properties of the little groups, their Casimir operators, their generators, and the various quantum numbers which they produce in all possible situations that occur in one particle physical states. We are essentially left with two possibilities, and I will describe the possibilities in more detail in a little while. But one can now ask what happens to any other labels one can construct from looking for new generators or contracting them with each other to construct new kind of Casimir operators. It turns out that other scalar Casimir operators constructed from this Poincaré generators either vanish or reduce to those for the Lorentz group. And in that sense, there is nothing much left after going as far as in this particular analysis. We have the four momentum vector p mu and this little group labeled by W, and they completely exhaust the various possibilities. And just for example, one can form contractants like p alpha p beta contracted with j alpha beta. This happens to be 0 for trivial reasons of symmetry. Things like j alpha beta contracted with the completely antisymmetric epsilon symbol, it reduces to other objects also belonging to the Lorentz group. So, they are not independent objects anymore. So, this is as much as I have to say about this one particle state, and next time I will describe the explicit structure of the different components of the little group for both massless and massive particles.